Hello, everybody. Happy New Year. Happy New Jumper. Happy New Vlogs. We're back. It's 2017. And I don't know about you, but I'm kind of glad to see the back of 2016. I mean, not from a reading point of view. I read some amazing, amazing books last year. And I had a lovely time on here chatting to all of you. But the year itself was a bit weird. And I kind of hope that 2017 is going to be a little less extreme. But I am also really, really excited about some of the books that we have got coming in 2017, as I sort of hinted at towards the end of last year. And so I thought I would do a video where I would sort of tell you a bit about some of the books that you have got to look forward to, just to put a few into your mind so that you can look out for them when they arrive. And then to give you an idea of, you know, how hard my poor life is here, I started to compile a list and it just started to get out of control. And I thought, this is too long. So I've decided to restrict myself to sort of the first 3 months of the year or so. And even that's quite a long list. So I'm going to do a video here where I talk about fiction, and then I'll do another video where I talk about some of the non-fiction that's coming up. But the most important thing to stress is that there are some amazing, amazing, amazing books. And I've already read some of them, and I have got plans to read some of the others. I will try and give you a hint of what some of them are about, but these are just sort of some of my own personal favourites. But before we get to that, last year, 2016, so last year, the last video I did, I was talking about George Saunders' debut story collection, which is called Civil War Land in Bad Decline. And his debut novel is coming this year. But I went back to read those stories, which are utterly, utterly, utterly brilliant. And I had two copies to give away. And the winners of those copies are Ben Parker and Akin to a Ray of Sunshine. So congratulations, both of you. You will find my email address at the bottom of this video's description. Send me your postal addresses and I'll get those copies off to you as soon as I can. That's that done with. Let's start talking books, shall we? I'm just going to pick one off the top of this pile and see what it is. This is Montpelier Parade by Karl Geary. Karl Geary is his debut novel. He was an actor. Indeed, he may still be doing some acting, but I think he's probably focusing on the writing now. And indeed, I hope he is, because the writing is just fantastic. If you want to find out about him as an actor, type into YouTube, seeing as you'll hear Karl Geary, Sex in the City, and you'll see him. You'll see quite a lot of him. Anyway, this is Montpelier Parade, and this is his debut novel, and it is really, really, really brilliant. I've been able to do a little interview with him, which you'll be able to hear on the Vintage Podcast. If you are not subscribed to the Vintage Podcast, you are crazy. I will leave a link below for you to follow. We've got just fantastic authors on there all the time. And indeed, at the end of last year, The Guardian picked it as one of their top 50 podcasts of the year. What more do you want? Anyway, Montpelier Parade is the story of an unconventional friendship or relationship between a boy called Sonny, who is a young lad, and an older woman called Vera. And this is in sort of, as you can tell, sort of 1950s Dublin. And it's just beautifully nuanced and subtle relationship writing. And what's really interesting about it is it's written in the second person, which you do not hear very often or do not read very often in novels. And at the beginning, I was a bit like, oh, this is a bit strange. And then you completely kind of get caught in it. There's something about the rhythm of it that really suits an Irish voice, actually. And so it kind of makes sense. But as I say, the depiction of this relationship between these two people is really beautifully done. And the very clever way that he holds back information about characters and their motivations until really right until the very end, you discover something that changes your perspective of the whole novel and actually might do that thing of often making you want to go back to the beginning and read it all again. It's just a beautiful book. So I really, really recommend that if you're after some debut fiction, Montpelier Parade by Karl Geary. Now, next. Okay, so Atessa Moshfegh, you may remember her from last year, shortlisted for the Booker Prize for her novel Eileen. She's actually, in America, much better known as a short story writer. She has won some amazing short story prizes. And this is a collection of short stories called Homesick for Another World. And I had so much fun reading these because she's an amazing short story writer. If you read Eileen and loved it, there is just so much more here for you to enjoy. If you found Eileen a bit of a challenge or, you know, weren't quite sure about it, I think that you should really think about giving these stories a go because there is something about the distilled nature of her writing in these which suits her really, really well. And there is a nice variety in this book. They're actually really funny at the same time as being quite worrying and a bit gross in many places. But her skills as a writer are just insane. And there'll be a video here in time where I get to talk to her a little bit about her short story writing. But I really recommend that. Zadie Smith on the top of this copy saying, razor sharp short stories. And that's a great, great description. They really are just fantastically cutting. So there you go. That is Homesick for Another World, stories from Atessa Moshfegh. Later in the year, there will be her debut novella, I suppose. It's called McGlue. It was published before Eileen in America, but coming to our shores a little bit later in the year. Next, we have Tessa Hadley, Bad Dreams. This is another story collection. Tessa Hadley's The Past, I read last year and absolutely adored. And she's one of those writers who I said, I must read more of her work. And so that is exactly what I will do. I haven't read Bad Dreams yet, but my understanding is that she is an amazing short story writer. And I'm determined, I think, this year to read a few more stories because they're really lovely to dip into. They're good if you do what I do, which is to read on a journey, or if you've just got a bit of time in the evening in which to read. I think stories can be a perfect thing to sort of dip into, enjoy and savour, and then move on to something else, you know, like the washing up. Anyway, this book. Okay, I can't wait to tell you about this. This is The End of Eddie by Edouard Louis. And this is his debut novel. It's an autobiographical novel. It is about a boy called Eddie growing up in northern rural France and being surrounded by extreme poverty. And the effect of this poverty on his own family and those around him is that it has bred this discontent and anger, and he is encountering on a daily basis extreme racism, homophobia, and things like that. And this is whilst he is discovering his own sexuality, which is that he is gay. And so you can imagine being surrounded by that kind of atmosphere when you're discovering your own sexuality. It's terrifying. And in many ways, this is a story about somebody who is not trying to sort of show themselves as being different. He's desperately, desperately trying to fit in, to not be different. And it's an extraordinarily visceral depiction of what it means to be working class in France. And it's important because what he's doing is giving a voice to people who don't have their voice listened to very often. You will remember in 2016, that year that we are very glad to say goodbye to, there were a lot of people who felt that they were disenfranchised, who hadn't been listened to, and used the various democratic voting methods that they might have at their disposal to register their protests. So whether it was Brexit in Britain or Trump in America, we'll have the French elections coming up in France very, very soon. And this is why this kind of book is so important, because it actually gives a voice to people who are not used to being listened to. And what they have to say is very important. And it is only through using things like art, and more importantly, of course, democracy, to give people a voice, that we can avoid those kind of extremes that we saw in 2016 and which are really unhelpful, I think, in terms of making progress. So this book is important, but it's not just important. It's amazingly written. Edouard is incredibly intelligent, sensitive and well-read young man. And so he has put an awful lot of work into the style and the form of this novel. And he's got a lot of very big influences on his writing. But what is most important is this heart that beats all the way through it. It's just so filled with the importance of telling the truth, and there is no doubting his veracity. So you will be hearing a lot more about Edouard Louis, but to begin with, you can start by reading this amazing, amazing book. Moving on. So, no surprise to anybody here that I'm a big fan of John Burnside. So when a new novel arrives, very, very exciting. There is actually a new novel and a new poetry collection coming from John Burnside in 2017. And Ashland & Vine is kind of a bit of a departure for him, because many of his novels are set in the north or in Scotland or in the far north, the Arctic Circle. They're often very sort of cold and based on folklore and things like that. And so it was quite weird. You can see immediately here from the cover that this is a novel which is set in America, which is sort of like, whoa, that's a bit weird. And that's what's really interesting, is that he's not only set it in a place that he's not known for writing in, but he's absolutely engaging in American history and culture in order to tell a story which is ostensibly about a young woman who is doing a sort of film project. She's going around her neighbourhood, and the idea is that she's supposed to go and talk to a neighbour and get them to tell her a story. She's then supposed to relate this story back to her boyfriend, who is a filmmaker. That is the project. Except that when she encounters one woman who will not tell her anything about her life until she agrees to come back the next day and be sober, because she can tell that this girl is an alcoholic. And it's all about her staying sober. So as long as she continues to stay sober, she will tell her another part of her own story. And so through the course of this book, you discover this woman's story. And through her story, you hear about a period in American culture and politics, the sort of late 50s, early 60s, which of course is dealt with in a novel like American Pastoral, which I spoke about last year, Philip Roth's novel. In fact, this book has many ways in which it crosses over with that book, looking at a similar theme and a similar kind of period of politics in America. So yeah, a bit of a departure and a very interesting one for John Burnside, and obviously a must for any Burnside fans out there. So there we go, that is that. Next, another American book here, Idaho by Emily Roskovich. I'm not going to say too much about this book because I don't really want to spoil it, but it is about the fallout from a catastrophic event, and it is a book about the unreliability of memory when one of the characters is a man who is suffering from dementia, I suppose, memory loss. And so therefore, of course, his memory is not something to be relied on, and it is about the intersection of lives and how these sort of fleeting contacts that we have with people can be very important. And it is about imprisonment and freedom and love and identity, making a new life for yourself. It's an incredibly rich book, writing fantastic, and I'm still processing it, which is partly why I'm not going to tell you too much about it, because I don't want to get anything wrong. But you know what I mean, when you read a book and it's so sort of rich that you need a bit of time to kind of process it. And that's how I feel about this book at the moment, to the point where I was actually talking to somebody else about it in the offices, and we had come to a completely different conclusion about what had actually happened in the book, which is really interesting when that happens. So I'm not even sure I know what happens in the book. Deal with that. So that's Idaho by Emily Roskovich. Two more to go. Bear with me. This is A Natural by Ross Razan. Ross Razan is a fantastic, fantastic writer. You may have previously heard of books like Waterline or God's Own Country. This is A Natural. This is just a proof copy, but it is about a footballer. It is about the sort of macho culture that exists in football and why that is difficult for this particular footballer because he is gay. And I haven't read this book yet, but I absolutely will be because, as I said, I have read Ross Razan before and I think he's a fantastic writer. And I'm also really interested about these themes of, you know, men trying to fit into sort of macho cultures where they don't feel that they fit in. And I have this sort of sense, this feeling that if there is a person who is well placed to sort of write that novel, that person is Ross. So that is coming in March. So we're getting into March now, and there is just one more book to go. I'm telling you about a lot of new books here, but I also know that a lot of you love, love, love classics. And so I want to tell you about a big, big new classic, which is coming to the vintage Red Spines. And this is The Dollmaker by Harriet Arnau. Now, some of you may have heard of this book because I mentioned it when I did that video with Jen. A link for that will appear here, where I was talking about American classics. And we've been talking about the fact that a lot of the American classics I had read had been written by men. This, of course, is written by a woman. And I'm very, very excited to get into this. It's quite big, as you can see, so I will get to it. But this is, again, another March publication. And it sounds amazing. It's about a woman moving from rural America to Detroit in the late 1950s, and living in extreme poverty. But she also has this skill, which is that she makes these beautiful dolls. But as a depiction of an America which has been polarised, where there are the haves and the have-nots, it feels very prescient, shall we say, or very important to be reading a book like that now. And that's why I think it's going to be one of those exciting rediscovered classics, and that is coming later in this year. That's your lot for now. And as I said, that's just kind of January, February, March. And that's even just the ones that I've selected. There are so many other books that I could have told you about. And I find it quite hard to restrict myself. And even restricting myself, this has been quite a long video. So thank you for sticking with me. There will be another video next week where I'll be talking about nonfiction. I'm not even going to touch on poetry because, as I hinted last year, Candice is going to be doing some fantastic stuff with poetry this year. There is some really, really exciting, young, diverse stuff coming in 2017. And then very soon I'll be talking to you about actual books and giving copies away, which I know you love. So don't worry, that will be coming very, very soon. But in the meantime, Happy New Year. It's good to be back. And I'll see you next week.